good. The devil's a liar. Let us know the difference. Because that's what God wants to talk to us about today. Knowing the difference. Amen. Knowing the difference from God and God being truth and the devil being a liar. Amen. Let's get ready for the reading of the word. Let's turn, thank you, sir. Turn to 1 Thessalonians. Because I definitely want us to know and understand this word today does not come from Apostle. I pray that you receive it as though you know it comes from who? God. Because I can't. My thoughts and opinions are not what matters. It's the word of God that matters. Go to 1 Thessalonians 2nd chapter, verse 12 and 13. On the count of three, we're going to read it together. One, two, three. That ye walk worthy of God, who has called you unto his kingdom and glory. For this cause also thank we God without ceasing. Because when ye received the word of God, which ye heard of us, you received it not as the word of men, but as in the truth, the word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe. Point your hand to yourself and say, I believe. Therefore, I am being transformed. I want you to do me a favor while you are there. When you sit down, I want you to underline where it says, it is not as not the word of men, but as in the truth, the word of God. I want you to underline as in the truth, the word of God. You receive it as it is the truth, the word of God. Because God's word is what? God's word is what? Truth. That may, in the time that we're in and the society we're in, that might, to some people, may be debatable. But I have you to understand that it's never debatable. God's word is always, absolutely, positively, always truth. Amen? You may have those, that's why I have you, be careful when people say, well, you know what, I only believe in some part of the Bible. I don't believe in or certain parts of the word of God. Well, that's your problem, because that just because you don't believe in something doesn't make it not truth. Amen? Just because you won't accept something doesn't mean it's not true. Because somebody like say, well, I don't really believe in this. I don't believe in the resurrection. Just because you don't believe in it doesn't make it not true. Everybody understand? And what's interesting about truth, truth has a tendency to reveal the fruit that reveals it is truth. In other words, truth will manifest and show you that it is truth. Just watch it long enough. Just watch. Just like a lie will show up. A lie. Somebody tell you, I love you. I'll never leave you. I'm going to be there for you. A lie will has a tendency to manifest itself and show you that the person was lying. The only problem with that is if you believed it as the truth, when you found out it was a lie, you probably were hurt, broken, and feeling messed up. Am I right or wrong? Am I right or wrong? Most of us in this room were hurt and broken and feeling messed up because you believe a truth was, you believe something was true, but you found out later it was a lie. Or you found out something was true, but somebody couldn't live up to that truth. Amen? It is truth that a mother should love her daughter, but that doesn't mean that mother's going to walk in truth. It is truth that a father should love his son. That doesn't mean that father's going to walk in that truth. Can I get amen? And just because that father doesn't walk in that truth doesn't change it from being true. Everybody don't hear what I just said? Just because that father doesn't walk in that truth doesn't change the fact that it still remains as a truth. Just because we will not yield to the truth does not make that truth not true. Are you with me? I want to kind of take my time. I want to establish it so we can understand. We want to really get this morning. The first thing we want to get is, let's go to, in the word, let's go to John 1:14. Sometimes the problem with you and I sometimes is that we have a problem. We have
a problem trying to break away from a lie and walk in the truth. The problem, sometimes everyone in this room, some of our biggest struggles is if you're trying to release a lie and trying to walk in the truth. Can I get an amen? And the problem with some of us is that you don't know that it's a lie yet, so you're still trying to hold on to it. Anybody ever seen someone try to hold on to a lie because in their mind, everybody else knows it's a lie, but in their mind, they still think it's the truth. Has anyone ever seen that? You know what? You're going to try to hold on to a lie. Girl, he cheating. He loved it, but you know what? He loved me. You're trying to hold on to a lie, which, in your mind, you may perceive it's the truth, but it's still a lie. I want you to read 1:14. What does it say?
John chapter 1, verse 14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
So the Word became flesh, and we beheld his glory as the only one of the glory of the begotten God, as God himself. But he was full of what?
Grace and truth.
Come on, church, I need to hear you. He was full of what? So this Jesus Christ, who was the Word, who became flesh. I mean, know that Jesus was the Word. God, Jesus Christ didn't have a natural father. His father was God himself. Can I get an amen? His father was God himself, and he was the Son of God. And the Bible says the Son was full of grace and truth. Full of it. Meaning that's the very essence of what he was grace and truth. But what I want to talk a lot, how many of us have heard a lot of sermons about grace? And that's a good thing. Everybody say good thing. That's an outstanding, the gospel of grace, that's an outstanding thing. But I know that God wants to ponder. We're going to ponder a little bit on, I don't know how long, but we're going to talk a lot for a little while on truth. I don't know how long, because there's something powerful about understanding that he was full of grace and truth. Everybody say grace and truth. Say truth. Look at somebody, say, give us the truth. That's what we need. He was full of grace and truth. And we do a lot of preaching on grace, which is truth. It is good to preach on grace. I have nothing. The revelation of grace is absolutely true. It is powerful. But the Bible says he was full of grace and He is the out of the begotten. He is from God himself. He is God. So if he's full of grace, then he is full of truth. He is truth. So we need to talk about that truth, because the problem with some of us today that we are struggling with truth. Amen. Amen. He is full of grace and truth. But let's find out what does truth do a little bit. Let's go to John 17:17. He was full of grace and truth. God himself came down in the fleshly body of man. And inside that fleshly body of man was a spirit full of grace and truth. I'm glad he was full of grace, because that means he had something I couldn't get. God gave us his son, something we couldn't do for ourselves. But there was another side, there was something else he was full of. You can't ignore what else he was full of. He was full of truth. And there's something about that truth. And what does it say? What does John 17 say?
John chapter 17 and verse 17. Sanctify them by your word.
Okay, he sanctified. Everybody say sanctified. By the word. The word that was made flesh. We were sanctified by the word. So Jesus Christ, who was the word made flesh, came to sanctify us. Everybody say hallelujah. The Bible says he came to sanctify you and I. Sanctify, that word sanctify means to set apart. Everybody write it. I want you to have a definition of it. To be sanctified means to be set apart. I want you to read the verse above 17. What does it say?
Verse 16. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world.
He's saying they are not. Who are not of the world?
The disciples.
Those he's sanctifying, they are no longer of this world. Ooh. Look at somebody say, I'm here, but I'm not. Say, I'm here, but I'm not of here.
I'm here, but I'm not of here.
In other words, he came to set us apart from the world system. Amen. Last week he talked about who is my neighbor. We're going to ponder on that too. He came to set us apart from the world system. He who loveth the world and the things in it, the love of God is not in him. He came to sanctify. But how is he going to sanctify us? Finish it.
Your word is truth.
Woo! He said, if you believe my word, that my word is truth, and that truth should sanctify you. He was full of grace and truth, but the truth that he was full of should have took you. The Bible says, in the world is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. In the world is the lust of the flesh, means your any desire you want, whatever your flesh wants is in the world. Lust of the eye, whatever you see you gotta have. And the pride of life, you think you're greater than anybody else, and nobody can't tell you anything. Anybody been like that? Everybody in this room better raise your hand. Stop lying. We was either lust of the flesh, lust of the eye. Why? Because you was in the world system. Before you accepted God and I accepted God, we was in the world system. Can I get an amen? And the Bible says that the father of the system of the world was a what? A what in the beginning?
A liar.
He was a murderer and a what? The Bible says that the father of the system of the world was a murderer and a liar from the beginning. He's the one that started the world system. When Satan lied, he told Eve he was a liar and a murderer from the beginning. The world system that is operating, even this system in the United States, is a system that is operated by a father who is a murderer and a liar. So hallelujah. But thank God that he sent his only begotten son. Come on, y'all. He sent his only begotten son. And his son, the Bible said he was the word. And I like in the book of Hebrews, he said, I'm in the volume of the book, it is written of me. He said, I'm in the volume. Jesus said, I'm in the volume of the book, it's written of me. In other words, when you open up that Bible, he says, it's written of me. I'm in that book. When you see me, you see. And Jesus said, when you see me, you see the Father. And the Father that you see came to sanctify you, sets you apart from the father of a system that's a murderer and a liar. So if Satan is the father of lies, then God must be the establisher of truth. And he says, my word is what separates you. My word is what separates you. Oh, my God. My word is what separates you. Say, y'all, we need to write it down. It is the word of God. That's why the enemy don't like you studying the word. That's why he don't mind you doing everything else. And then we want to take the word and try to use it for our own benefit. When the word by itself came to separate you, the word came to reunite you, to wash you and to cleanse you and to establish you back with your
father.
Who is the father of
truth?
Eve's problem was she believed a
lie.
And the Bible says a little leaven, leaven the whole lump. Unleavened bread has no leaven in it. What is God saying to us? A little lie will change a whole situation. God does not tolerate any lies. That means we can't, the Bible says anything that's not done in faith is what? If it is not done in faith, they come by what? Hearing the what? He says, when you move outside of my word, all Satan did was tell Eve that the word of God was not true. Some of us are going to get a wake-up call this morning. Not when you move in your emotions. You can't please God moving in your emotions. You can't please God moving in your feelings. Your feelings and emotions must be in alignment with the
word.
Because the word is. You can cry all day and be emotional all day. But some of you, I've seen people cry and emotional all day, but their feelings and their tears came from a lie. Came from a lie. Because they believed the lie, and that lie produced an emotional roller coaster. Amen? But God wants to talk to us about the truth. We there. You with me, right? So we understand he was full of what?
Grace and truth.
And the truth He said that we are sanctified by what? His word. And his word is what? So it is the word of God that makes you separated from the world system. Look at somebody and say, are you in the word? Let's look at it. Let's kind of examine this. Turn your Bibles with me to 1 John, the second chapter. I'm sorry. No, let's go to 2 John. Who is my neighbor? 2 John, the first verse. Begin to read.
2 John, verse 1. The elder to the elect lady and her children.
I want you to understand what I love about this. I want you to underline the elder. An elder is someone mature in the system of God. Amen? An elder is someone who is mature in the system of God. And the elder is talking to the lady and her children. Amen? Go ahead.
To the elect lady and her children, whom I love in truth.
I want you to underline that because I love that verse. That verse jumped in my spirit. When I was on my knees praying, he told me to go to 2 John and 3 John. And when I went, that verse jumped off the pages. He said, whom I love in truth. The question God wants to ask, who is my neighbor? The question God wants to ask us today, whom do you love and is it in truth? Whom do you love and is it in truth? The woman, the elder is speaking to the woman and her children, but the elder said, and whom I love in truth. I don't love her in my flesh.
Amen. My God. Yeah.
God began to say, oh my God, when it came to relationships, did you love the person in truth? When we talk about establishing things, do you love them in truth? Or do you love them just in your emotions? Watch this. Emotions can change. Truth cannot.
That's right.
Do you love them? See, when you love them in your emotions, you believe you can still act the way you want to act. When you love them in your emotions, you feel like you can still talk the way you want to talk. When you love them in your emotions, you feel like you can you say, I love you, but I can just act any way I want to act. But there's a difference when you love them in truth.
That's right.
Do you love them? I could just preach on that all because that thing leaped out of my spirit. I said, I got it right. Man, it changed how I saw some things. Because he said, you know what? In whom I love in truth. God says, I got a lot of people who talking about they love, but do they love in truth? Is it a sanctified type of love? He told husbands, he said, husbands, love your wife as Christ loved the church that he gave his life. And then the Bible says he sanctified her. Oh, when you are a man, can you sanctify her in truth? Can you make sure she feels like she's set apart by the word of God? In truth. That thing gave a whole different view on some situation because there's a lot of people on television, I love you. And they say, I love you. But you need to ask somebody when they talk about when they say they love you, ask them, do you love me in truth? Because only truth is going to cause me to be away from the judgment of God. Now I understand even more when God used to have me say, I'm going to love you to the protecting of your soul. You can never love someone to the protecting of their soul until you love them in truth.
That's right. Right there.
And truth is not some emotional thing. Truth is not some feeling thing. Truth is the unadulterated gospel, the word of God. Truth says, I love you so much, even though I'm angry, I watch how I speak to you. truth says, you know what? You fine in the wine. You were so sexy. But truth say, I won't even touch your lips unless I get a covenant. Because truth is connected to holiness.
Hallelujah. That's right.
Oh, we going to get this today. He said, I love him. I'm not going to spend a home in truth. Keep on reading it, though. Keep on reading. I'm going to write that down. I'm going to ponder on that for probably the next 10 years. If God help me here. Go ahead.
Whom I love in truth. And not only I.
Not only I.
But also all of those who have known the truth.
He said, not only I, but everybody that knows truth going to love you. Everybody that knows truth going to recognize woman and you and your children. Everybody that knows truth going to love you. So you don't have to worry about everybody hating you in the world, because those who know truth won't be hating you. Woo! So you don't have to worry about everybody turning their back, because those who know truth, they'll never turn their back.
Hallelujah.
Why? Because those who know truth says, God says, I'll never leave you, nor will I forsake you. Not even in the midst of the storm.
Hallelujah.
I might let you go, but I won't leave you. Some of y'all going to get there. Because some people need to be let go. In the book of Acts, he said, turn them over. That truth may put them on the right course. He said, everybody that know truth. See, the world, they don't know truth. But he said, my people, my sons and daughters, they going to love you. That means in the church, it ain't that envy and jealousy. It ain't that backbiting, because everybody that know truth, woman and your children, going to love you. Because they know in my kingdom, there is no cliques. He said, everybody that knows you, keep on reading. Come on, keep on reading.
But also all of those who have known the truth, because of the truth which abides in us and will be with us forever.
The truth going to be with us when?
Forever.
That's that thing that don't change. The truth going to be with us forever. That's the thing that's unchangeable. See, God's word is truth. When they can change presidents, they can change law, they can do what they want to do. But they can't change. That's going to stay consistent forever. If you want to be in a safe place when everything going truth, make sure that you are standing on truth. Finances can change. Health can change. But make sure you are engrafted in. Keep on reading.
Verse 3.
Uh-huh.
Grace, mercy, and peace will be with you from God.
How many know those things going to be with you if you're in truth? If you're in truth, you're not going to have no grace, mercy, and truth. But when you stand on truth, even when a storm comes, you know why. Why? Because when you stand on truth through the storm, you're going to have, you know God's mercy is present. You know grace is there. And what else?
And grace, mercy, and peace.
God's peace. When you stand in truth, grace, mercy, and peace will never leave you. Because God said in his word, I'll never leave you. See, truth, sometimes the truth you stand on, it may not look like it in the natural. But see, God's word is able to transcend the natural. If God said, let there be light and there's no sun, light going to appear because he speaks the truth. We got to get this. It was void. And if, no matter if you empty, when God is present, when truth is present, if God said in your belly shall flow rivers of living water, you will never thirst again. Truth. Read it.
Grace, mercy, and peace will be with you from God the Father.
From God the Father.
And from the Lord Jesus Christ.
And from the Lord Jesus Christ.
The Son of the Father.
The Son of the Father.
Who's in truth and love.
Who's in what?
Truth and love.
Truth and love. How many of you know you cannot separate truth from love? If you're going to be in love, if you're going to walk in love, in God's love, in whom? Well, let's see. I got to say it again. I got to go back to the top again. He says, whom I love in the truth. If you're going to show love to someone, you must operate in the truth. And the Bible said he was full of grace and the Bible said we were sanctified by the word, and the word is, when you love someone, he said, in whom I love in truth. The question, I got to keep saying it, do you love in truth? Is your love based upon truth? The kind of love that's based upon truth don't look like the world. Actually, it separates you from the world. I know we like to read these fairy tale books. I know we like to watch these, but the love of the sanctification love, it don't look like the world love. Go ahead.
Verse 4. I rejoice greatly that I have found some of your children walking in truth.
Somebody should have screamed on that, though. Somebody should have screamed. He said, the elder said, I rejoice that I have found some of your children. He's talking to the woman and children. Walking in what?
In truth.
In truth. Come on. I don't know a pastor or a teacher. I don't know an evangelist or a prophet. Anyone that's laboring in the kingdom, their greatest joy is to see the children of God walking in truth. To see them walking in truth. Because if they walking in truth, they definitely walking in
love.
That's why I cannot preach myself. I must preach Christ Jesus and myself a servant. Why? Because it is the word that ushers you into truth, which brings you to a place of love. Truth. He was full of truth. He said, the elder said, in whom I love in truth. And he said, I rejoice. Great. See, people, now we rejoicing if we see people pay their tithes. That's good, because you should pay your tithes. We rejoicing to see people singing. That's good. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Amen. We rejoicing when we see people dance. That's good. We know we got to dance unto the Lord. But are we rejoicing in how we see people treat one another? See, all those things you're doing for God. But how about when you're dealing with one another? Do whom we love in truth. Do you love somebody in truth? We like to say, God, I love you. But God got some, we're going to find out in the word, God got some things to let you know if you're talking about you love him. If you're going to walk in the word of God, you're going around talking about how much you love God. That's good, but I just want to talk to you and me. The Bible says that the tree bears some and the fruit benefits some people. Amen? Keep reading.
I rejoice greatly that I have found some of your children walking in truth, mm-hmm, as we have received commandment from the Father.
He said, I found some of your children walking in truth that we have received commandments from the Father. We receive a word and we find some of your children lining up with it. Go ahead.
Verse 5. And now I plead with you, lady, not as though I wrote a new commandment to you.
He said, this ain't new, but it's new. Go ahead.
But that which we have had from the beginning.
He said, I want to tell you something, something God didn't do away with. And that is to love God with all. That's what we found out last week that God, see, people want to talk about, but God began to say, hold up, there's something people talking, and they when they talk about the law, they ignore this right here. When he says, this is my commandment. He says, last week, he said, how can I enter into the kingdom? How do I have, he said, how shall I receive eternal life? Last week he talked about, am I right, the neighbor, he said, when he talked about the what? The good neighbor, right? The Samaritan. He said, to love God with all thy heart, thy soul, thy mind, and thy strength. But to love thy neighbor as thyself. He didn't have no problem talking about he loved God. He didn't complain about what how he felt. But then he tried to justify himself and saying, well, who is my neighbor? But the elder tells the woman in John 1, she says, the elder says, in whom I love in truth. And everybody rejoices that they see your children walk in the truth. Because we found out that, you know, Jesus kind of broke it down for him that who his neighbor was. Because, you know, we like to choose who we want to love. But the question is, do you love in truth? The question is, and do you, not one selected person, do you love everybody in truth? Because, you know, we got biased type of love. We got a biased type of love. I love all black people in truth. I love you. But when it comes to white people, I'm not really feeling that, especially in the United States today. I'm not really feeling all this racism and all of it. But you see, but those in whom know truth know that's not God. Those in him in know truth know that God has no respect to person. Come on, y'all. God has no respect to person. And this love, the Bible says he so loved the world that whomsoever, he didn't say whomsoever black, whomsoever white, whomsoever Spanish. He didn't even say whomsoever Jew. He said whomsoever, because he had a plan to bring them both to one anyway. Amen. Keep on going. We about to finish. Go ahead. This part right here.
A new commandment, but one that you've had from the beginning.
Can I ask y'all a question? How many of y'all know a commandment is not, when you command and ask a commandment, you're not asking anybody to do anything. This is a requirement. Don't let people fool you. Oh, God has some requirements. Why? Because love has some boundaries. Love with no boundaries is lust. Love has some boundaries. He said, no one, but it's not. Go ahead. Keep on going.
That we shall love one another.
That we shall love who?
One another.
See, that's what he was trying to teach the lawyer last week, the neighbor, that we need to love one another. Jesus said, that's the truth. He said, that's the truth. He said, if you're reading my word and my word is going to teach you that you must have a love for one another. If you say that you are my disciples, and he said, how will the world know that you are my disciples in the way you love? Why? Because you're in the truth. Disciples are those who are disciplined in the one they are following. If they're disciplined in Jesus Christ, who is the Word made flesh, full of grace and truth. If they are full of him who is full of grace and truth, then guess what? Since Jesus so loved, since there's no greater love than one who laid down his life, then there's a requirement. Oh, there's a requirement. How do we know? He says, deny yourself and pick up your cross. He said, you must be willing to lose to gain. Amen? Keep on reading.
Verse 6. Now this is love.
This is love.
That we walk according to his commandments.
Okay, hold up. And this is love. That we walk according to his word. To what he has commanded. Love in whom we love in truth. He said, this is love. He said, I don't want to leave it to your own imagination. He said, I don't want to leave it to your poets and your songwriters. I don't want to leave it to your own interpretation. He said, in this is love, that you do what I say.
That's right.
Because what I say is truth. See, if what I'm saying is bad, see, he said, I'm not the father of lies. I'm the God of truth. And what I'm saying is a reflection of my love for you. So if I tell you, wait till you get married, that's love talking to you. If I tell you, I don't want you not to lie because you're worried about going to hell, that's not, grace came and took care, but because truth, I want you not to lie. Because that's a benefit from truth. There's no benefits from believing a lie. Can I get an amen? If you put your heart in a lie, you're going to end up disappointed. You're going to end up broken. You're going to end up hurt and wounded. Why? Because that lie cannot produce what you're looking for. Look at somebody say, it's a camouflage. But he said, put your faith in my word. Because my thoughts towards you are not evil, but to give you hope in the future. Let my word be the light to your feet and the lamp to your path, because I got a destination to you. I went to my father's house. There are many mansions. If it were not so, I have hemmed out a place where I'm taking you. And while you're on this way, I'm going to add some things to you because I'm just crazy about you. I might add a husband. I might add some things, some children. But don't forget where I'm taking you. Because he said, where I'm at, surely will you be also. If it were not so, I wouldn't say it. He said, if it wasn't so, I only speak the truth. Because I'm the one who speaks the truth. You have to understand, everybody who receives me, they on their way to their mansion. That's why he said, don't let your heart get stuck on things down here. Don't let your heart get out. Why? Because you might start detouring your plan from where I'm taking you. Know that I'm in the truth. In the midst of the storm, stand on the truth. In the midst of adversity, walk through it with the truth. Oh, I love this truth thing. See, when I begin, he's saying, whom he loved in the truth, I begin to understand you just can't like the word. Oh, look at people. No, it's a love story. It's a love story of a father opening up his heart to his children. To children who are liars and deceivers and manipulators. Oh, thank God.
Hallelujah.
We was once in darkness. So glad he brought us out into darkness. Anybody glad?
Thank you, God.
Anybody glad that when we was in that darkness, he brought some truth? That he sent some truth to rectify some situations. Go ahead. We go here. Where we at? Hold up. No, hold up. We're going to stop there because I've noticed something about John's writing. There's a pattern. There's a pattern to John's writing. I'm going to show it to you. Let's go. We went to John. We went there. Now let's go to John, the second chapter. No, we're going to go to 1 John. I'm sorry, right? 1 John, second chapter. Thank you. See all these things going on today? The political game and all that, the Republicans, the Democrats, all this going on. All it's doing is, that system is just provoking people to hate one another, to be angry with one another. Sisters can't, I know, let me tell you a story, it's interesting. My mom go out of town, she go see a sister. These women, been sisters, they like twins. Twins. I'm talking about, you can't, my mom and her sister been twins, her oldest sister, they been twins for years. My mom come out of town, somebody, she couldn't wait till she get out back home because her sister was voting for Donald Trump. Are you serious? You let a political affiliation break up you and your, are you, you got to be joking. Man, I don't care who in that office, Trump, Obama, Obama, Trump, they ain't doing me no, they ain't the truth. They're not the truth. Neither one of them taught me how to love my enemy. And not neither one of them died for me. Now don't get me wrong, I honor them in their position. The same way I honor Obama, I honor Donald Trump. Why? Because my Bible tells me that no, every power that is established by God. You might not like it, but you better walk in truth. Love what God doing. Just because you don't understand it don't mean it's not good. Just because you ain't figured out why God done it, why God is doing it, don't mean it's not good. Amen. And be very careful of these so-called leaders whose commitments are to some political affiliation. I'm talking about spiritual leaders. More than their commitment to the God and whom they should serve with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength. Amen. Let's read. Because there's something about when you begin to walk in truth. When you begin to receive the word that sanctifies you, that sets you apart from a worldly system, where there's lust of the eye, pride of life, what lust of the flesh and the pride of life. There is something about that begins to happen in you when the word begins to get inside you, begins to wash you and cleanse you. When your mind begins to be renewed in the mind, in the word, there's something that begins to happen. Begin to read the first verse.
1 John chapter 1, verse 1. That which was from the beginning.
Second chapter.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Chapter 2, verse 1. My little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin.
Come on. He said, I want to talk to you, my little children. See, we found out in 1 John with the woman's children, he was rejoicing because they were walking in. But right here, he's talking to some children again. He's talking to them. He said, now I need to talk to you about not sinning. Because to sin is to miss the mark. Everybody say, what mark? The mark of truth. That's all sin is. All sin is to move contrary to truth. That's all Satan did. He got Eve to move contrary to the word of God. God told them not to not to eat of the fruit. He didn't say not touch. He said not eat. Why is that important? Why I'm going to throw that in there? Why is it important? Because sometimes when people add something to the word of God, it's a setup. Why is it a setup? Because when she touched that fruit and nothing happened, she began to believe that all it was a lie. But she added the lie, which caused her to the fall. God never told her not to touch. God said, we should never touch this fruit. So because she added to it, when she touched it, you know how it is. When God say, behold, God mean don't have sex. So I believe kissing and being all sitting between his legs and you know, laying on him, that's okay. Hold up. First of all, if you are a woman and you're not married, in the scripture, say it again, your affections belong to who? Now, do you want to change it? Now, if you want to change it, that's not me. Don't be mad at me. The Bible says if that's not your husband, because that's the only exception he gave you, then your affections belong to the... So, why are you giving your affections to somebody who ain't said, I do yet? Are we on? Look at somebody saying, in whom I love in truth. The question is, do you love them in truth? See, some of us in here, the problem, I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. What I found out is you have those who argue with God's truth. And what they do is they'll go find someone. You will. I promise you, you will. I promise you. Because what you're going to do is for you to have that affection to your flesh, you're going to find someone who's going to say, well, that's wrong interpretation. That's not really... But I think if you're single and it says your affection should belong to God, that's kind of like thou shalt not lie. I mean, I don't think it's thou shalt not lie in case a situation occur. I don't think it's thou shalt not lie unless thou are hungry and starving and you have to do what you have to do. I believe thou shalt not lie ever. I don't think you and I are going to be able to stand before God and say, well, God, it was just a little white lie. Because he said a little leaven. And since in him there is no shadow, there is no darkness, or no shadow of turning, there is no lie consisting in him. Because he is the truth. When he says something, it's going to happen because he's the very essence of what truth is. Amen. That means even when we look like we're going to starve, the refrigerator can be empty. You don't have to have a dime in your pocket. The Father tell you to set the table, just set the table. Why? There's a word that says, I shall provide all your needs according to your riches and glory. Since he cannot lie. Now what? If he don't bring something, then I guess you're supposed to be fasting. I'm not trying to be funny. The Bible tells me sometimes Paul was fasting. Read it. Paul was like, he would die for food. He was fasting. Because God is able to rain down manna from heaven. Oh, he can rain down. See, the enemy, sometimes God will delay to see if you will take a side deal. Why? To prove your heart, not his. How far will you stand on truth? How much temptation, how many tribulations do you have to go? What will call you to be in truth? That's why he said, He says what? Should we find out tribulation brings what? Perseverance. Will you persevere? And perseverance birth what? Character. Somebody need to see the character of God when tribulation comes. Someone who can stand on truth. Someone who say, I will not take a side deal. Someone who will say, you know what? I'm going to show you what love look like. I'm going to show you how I love God. Why? I'm going to stand on what he said. You look crazy. I just love him. That's why he said obedience is better than sacrifice. If you're not going to obey the word. Amen. Keep reading.
And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father.
Somebody say hallelujah. Hallelujah. Man, y'all need to praise on that. See, even if you sin, stop going. He said, if thou sin, see, y'all don't understand grace. Y'all see some people messing, oh my, I'm going to hell. Truth is sitting down and making intercession for you. Anybody been there? Well, you found yourself going in, and he had to say, go help my daughter. Go help my son, because they about to mess up. They about to come out their mouth the wrong way. Please go help them. And when conviction comes, not condemnation, it begins to make you become godly sorrow that what? That you have spoken in a matter of opposite of truth. Go ahead. I'm so glad he wrote. Anybody, we was praising this. He wrote because he wrote. What was the song we were just singing earlier? The resurrected king has resurrected me. Act like it then. If he resurrected from the dead, that means he can resurrect our crazy behind. So that means you are never without hope. That's the truth. Go ahead.
If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the
say
righteous.
Hallelujah for Jesus Christ. Go ahead.
Verse 2. Mm-hmm. And he himself is the propitiation for our sins.
He's the payment, the atonement, the gap closed through Christ Jesus. The bridge was broke. Jesus laid, come on, come across. Come back home. He said, it's finished. I done done it. I'm what you need. I'm what you need to get to your dad. I'm what you need. I'm the truth that brought you back home. Believeth in me. There's nothing gonna come after me on me. I'm it. Go ahead.
And not only for ours, but also for the whole world.
For the whole world. So we can't go around eliminating people. Can't go around eliminating people talking about, you know, that's what the word said. That's truth. Don't say eliminate people. He said for the whole world. So guess what? It's for the whole world now. God, he can't make you. Well, love is not going to make you. I can give you. You know, they say you could tell somebody the truth. God keeps showing us the truth. But some like darkness. I'm getting ahead. I'm getting my message this afternoon. Some don't want that truth. But it tells you why they like darkness. It says they like what they're doing. The truth, Lord, I know it's the truth. I ain't supposed to have this. Some people, anybody been in the street ministry and somebody told you, I know I'm not supposed to be doing this. But it's just too good. I know I'm not. I've heard women say, I know I'm not supposed to be with him. I even heard people say, God told me to let it go. Then I see him talking about they getting married. I'm like, but you told me. You said God told you, you said truth told you let it go. But the liar say, truth was lying. This feel good to my flesh. And you know what happened when you look at a lie long enough? The Bible says Eve, it began to look. She began to say, I don't know what God's talking about. I see some good qualities in this. God told me to let this job go. But they're talking about giving me a raise. I just see some good qualities in this. What you don't know is somebody going to come in that department and shoot it up a week from that day. What you don't know is that brother got a problem with commitment. What you don't know is that sister still love her ex who used to slap her in the mouth. So when you come in the room and she's still on Facebook saying hello to him after y'all got married, and now you getting angry. Talking about they need tea time. See, God knows the heart. Truth know them lies. Come on, all of us in this room, come on, let's be real. Truth know how to uncover them little secret lies that we got. But truth ain't watching. But love ain't met, because love said, I want you to uncover the lie because grace is there. Grace says, I don't want to condemn them by the lie. I want to show them a way to get back to the bridge. Y'all better get this. God is not exposing a lie to condemn. He already paid the price. He said, but watch this. But if I don't know that this is a lie, I need to wake up to the lie, because the lie, it's a terrible thing to be saved and be on the same roller coaster ride. Why? Because you won't let God show you the truth. How many of y'all know? Let's be real. We got to be real up here today. How many of us love for God to show us the truth about somebody else? As long as he don't turn that mirror to you. But like, yeah, God, she a backslider. Yeah, God, that brother loose. Yeah, God, I knew she was fake. Here come the mirror. God, I ain't fake. God, I'm not rebellious. This dream must mean somebody else, even though you was the one talking. You the one was driving in the dream. Usually the driver is the one in control. Let's keep reading. Because this is going to be good. Go ahead.
Verse 3. Now by this we know that we know him.
By this we know that we know him. See, the question is, I know in Corinthians, he said, you have not heard of Christ Jesus. There's a way to know if you know him.
Yeah,
right here. We can
read it. Go ahead. If we keep his commandments.
Say it again.
If we keep his commandments.
You know him because you do what he say. He said, why call me Lord and not do it? How can I be your Lord? You say that I'm Lord, and he ain't never denied. He's like, and you right? Oh, I am Lord and I am King. Don't ever get it twisted. I am Lord and I am King. But why call me Lord and do not what I say? Why call me Lord and think I freed? Freedom is obedience to the word. That's what freedom is. When I obey, watch this. If I obey the traffic signs, I'm free from going to jail and getting a ticket. Y'all look at me like I'm crazy. Okay, say you a Christian. Get on the expressway and do 95. Push that gas to my God. Oh, Jesus got me. Woo, 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 woo. Here come the chastening. What is the chastening for? To tell your behind, stop doing 95. Obey the law. Do the truth. Do the truth. Unless that law conflicts with the truth. Unless that law conflicts with truth. Men marrying men conflict with truth. Murdering babies in the womb conflict with truth. No child of God can be in compliance with that. You cannot be in compliance with something that's contrary to truth. Come on, man. Are we crazy? So we going to speak a lie and say we good. Is God the God of liars now? God forbid. Shall we continue and say, God forbid? We have an advocate. Advocate means get out of it. Even there's a way out of it. Don't practice it. Don't practice it. You might become good at it. Amen? Go ahead.
Verse 4.
Mm-hmm.
He who says, I know him, but yet does not keep his commandments, this man is a liar.
Say it again.
He who says, I know him, and does not keep his commandments, is a liar.
He who knows him and does not keep his word is a liar.
And the truth is not in him.
And the truth is not in him. That's why, I'm going to tell you something. My dad got upset with me. Because I told my dad, I said, Obama's not saved. I said, Obama's not saved. My dad said, you can't say that. I said, yes, I can. He said, you can't. I said, yes, I can.
Uh-oh.
He said, you judging him. I said, no, I'm not. I said, I never said he couldn't be saved. I didn't even say I wouldn't pray that he would get saved. I just recognize his state. I just recognize his condition. Why? Because if Obama's a saved, then that scripture is a liar. That scripture is wrong. Because not only he did not struggle. He wasn't fighting. He said, listen to his words. I have come to an evolution. That means he has evolved beyond truth. Because what he has said is not, man did not establish that. God is the God of covenant. So you're going to tell me this, but I'm going to tell you, this is how crazy the church is. I'm going to tell you how crazy we are today. He going to declare a covenant contrary to the word of God, and we're going to turn around and say he belonged to God. Is the kingdom now divided? Can a kingdom be divided against itself and still stand? Can God be truth and then establish a lie and yet say he is still God? Come on, man. Stop playing games. I'm not saying he cannot be saved. I'm saying pray that he be saved. Because if you think he is saved, then you are in error and you know not the scriptures. Because you can't declare a law. You can't declare a situation like that and then declare a word. That's what God says in Romans 1. God says those who do this, they did not retain the knowledge of God in their hearts. And he turned them over. And these were signs reflecting that their mind and their hearts did not belong to him. They believe, he turned them over to believe the lie that they wanted. But we say, well, grace ain't separated from truth either. He said, I didn't just say you a liar. He said, if the truth is not in you, watch this, it's going to be good. Say, it's going to be good. Jesus said, Romans 8:9, if you have not my spirit, you are what? And the Bible says that today it is better that I go and you shall receive the Holy Spirit. And he is the spirit of what?
True.
So if the spirit of truth is not in him, he was none of his. Watch this. There is one, I didn't say that we didn't struggle. I didn't say we're not, I'm not talking about somebody who is struggling with the truth and lack. Come on, amen. Oh, y'all gonna act like I'm the only one sometimes have a struggle with the truth. Come on, you in a battle. The Bible says the flesh wars against the and the spirit against the. There is a difference between somebody. There's a difference between somebody struggling with something than someone declaring something.
That's right.
If I begin to declare
right. That
lying is an acceptable thing and everybody does it, it's good and it's the way it's supposed to be. You know, you have to tell some white lies because you don't want to hurt nobody's feelings. Come on, people. I'm not in a battle. I'm in agreement. And what am I? What you are in agreement with, that's covenant, that's your father. But you got to understand, why did God establish that? He didn't establish that to expose Obama. He established it to expose this nation. He said, this nation does not desire to walk in truth. You got to see why. You know what Obama said, why? He said he saw the people. He said his best friends and his children's friends. He let people usher him away from to evolve beyond God. What was God saying to this nation? You are allowing
falsehood to usher you away from people. You are afraid of people. You hold your peace because of people.
We done got quiet. Okay.
It's the truth. I can't backpedal. It's not my truth. It's God's truth. So when you see it, your job is not to say he going to hell. Your job is to intercede and to pray for him and his family. But not only for him, to pray for this nation. Can I get an amen? We should be crying out for this. Everybody say, on the battlefield. Go ahead.
Verse 5.
Uh-huh.
But whoever keeps his word,
uh-huh,
truly the love of God is perfected in him.
Come on, say it again. Whoever keeps the word, the love of God, in whom I love in truth, whoever keeps the word, the love of God is being perfected. That word means complete, whole. The Bible says in Romans 5:5, hope leads are not ashamed, that the Holy Spirit is pouring the love. When the word is being poured in you, it's being what? Perfecting you, maturing you, completing you in the love. What Jesus did was the love of God. His actions were revealing to us the love of God. His actions were what he did for Lisa, what he did for me, what he did for you all. Going on that cross was an act of love. We had no entitlement. We were guilty as charged. None of us can stand before God and be like, you know, well, I felt like I fed the homeless. I did 5 Hail Marys a day. And I was nice to my mom most of the time. You're not going to walk into the kingdom of your own merits. We needed grace. Amen. But the evidence that grace is there is truth. Because truth transforms. You can't come into truth and stay the same. Why? You'll be convicted. When light hit darkness, darkness has to retreat. That's why the Bible says he was full of grace and truth. I gave you something that you didn't deserve, and I gave you something that's going to transform you. Why? So you can transform others and let them know about the grace you received. We getting it? Truth. Keep on.
By this, we know that we are in him. Verse 6. He who says that he abides in him ought himself also walk just as he walked.
Say it again.
He who says that he abides in him ought to himself walk just as he walked.
The word is a light to my feet and the lamp unto my path. Acknowledge him in all my ways. I thought that word was interesting. To acknowledge, accept, or admit the existence or of truth. To acknowledge that he is the truth and let that truth direct you. You know what's funny? In that truth, it's the same truth that corrects you. Why? Because he'll never leave you. His plan is he loves you. That's truth. But in that same truth, he'll tear your butt up. Amen? Because he don't want to see you bump your head. Go ahead.
Verse 7. Mm-hmm. Brethren. I write no new commandment to you.
He said, I'm not going to write a new one. There we go. We write. Now we're in 2. We were in 3 before. He says, chapter 3, he says, I don't write nothing new to you. He go back to the command. He said, I don't write nothing new to you. Go ahead.
But an old commandment.
But an old commandment that needs to be revived. That need to be made new, huh? That's what I say today. God ain't writing no new commandments. But he said, I need to revive the new one. The old one. I need to let you know I fulfilled this love in my Father. And if you're going to walk in me and walk like I am, you need to fulfill that love for one another. We don't need to be like the lawyer talking about who is my neighbor. Trying to justify ourselves in who we want to love. And whom I love in truth. Whom do you love in truth? Jesus loved the world in truth. As people.
not the system. He came to you, give us the truth to move us out. Because I'm going to tell you something. This world system going to be judged. She going to be judged. Just look at someone and say, hop on that train so you won't be here. Get yourself up. Get yourself up them train tracks. Because judgment coming. You better go read Revelation 19. He coming back with his sword drawn. He ain't coming on no donkey. He won't be on no donkey this time. I promise you. And they're talking about making war. We've already started making war against him. To make war against him is to make war against his word. We have already made war against him. And now God is crying. If you hear the trumpets blowing, God is saying, whose side you on? How many of you know? That's what Jezebel prophets did. They made war. They wanted to make war against God. God said, okay, it's time for a showdown. That's what God is saying to the United States. It's time for a showdown. So you need to choose this day whom you're really going to serve. Either you're going to serve God, you're going to be on my side or this side, because it's time for a showdown. This foolishness, the violence, the stink, the perverse, has come up to his nostrils as a stink. God says, I looked at the stink of the sin has come to his nostrils as a nation that says one nation under God, who now has many gods. A nation who now make laws as contrary to the word of God. God said, my sons and daughters, strap on. Get ready. Go ahead.
No new commandment, mm-hmm. but an old commandment which you have had from the beginning.
Yes.
The old commandment is the word which you have heard from the beginning.
The word that you heard from the beginning. Go ahead.
Verse 8.
Uh-huh.
Again, a new commandment I write to you.
He said, how many of you know he's reinforcing that it's not old, but it's new. But it's new to them because they need to understand what he's talking about. Y'all understand that, right? Go ahead. You're going to see. Watch.
Which thing is true in him and in you?
What thing is true in him and in you?
Because the darkness is passing away.
Because the darkness is passing away.
And the true light is already shining.
He said the darkness is passing away and the true light. Everybody say truth. That true light is already shining. The way of the word is already there. The way of the word is already shining in the midst of the darkness. See, that's going to be that revival. When it's time of love, that's going to be the revival. The way of the light. The way to love like Christ. The way to love to be able, like last week, what he said about the neighbor. The neighbor, the Bible said the man went and he banished his wounds. He said, can I get somebody to go banish somebody's wounds? The Bible, can I get somebody to dress somebody? He was stripped. He was on a donkey. He said, can I get somebody who don't mind using what you have to carry somebody else? Can I get somebody to pay the price for somebody else to have some rest? He said, because I'm tired of this generation that's so self-absorbed that all they want from me, all they talk about is what God doing for me. And so what I gave them already was nothing. I'm looking for a generation who's going to walk in some power, in whom I love in truth. The world needs to see the love of God in truth. That girl, Janet, that young lady dancing in G5, she needs to see the truth. Them brothers out there, gang banging, they need to see the truth. People get married. They need to see the truth. Young ladies being friends with young ladies, they need to see the truth. Brothers loving brothers, they need to see the truth. Because these lies about men, now men can't love men unless they perverted. Women can't love women unless they perverted. Marriages, we got the same arguing and fussing and bitter and all that. He said, I need to raise up those who don't love in the truth so I can put them on the hill that the world can have a way out of darkness. Go ahead.
Verse 9.
Uh-huh.
He who says that he is in the light, mm-hmm. and yet hate his brother, he is in darkness even until now.
Say it again.
He who says that he's in the light, mm-hmm. yet hates his brother, is in the dark even now.
He who says he is in the light, he who says he has the knowledge of Christ and hates his brother, you are in darkness. Look how he's measuring it. Lord, I'm prophesying. I'm in. But do you hate your brother? Who? Because that's what the lawyer said. He said, "Who is my neighbor?" See, we don't want to examine who's in your heart that you don't like. We're not fooling God. He didn't say, "Well, I'm a tolerate." He didn't ask you to tolerate anybody. He told you to love everybody. It's a terrible thing to think you in the light, but you really in darkness. Some of us, we got people, man. Y'all know some baby daddies and people in our life, moms, that you hate and you're angry and bitter with. You in the darkness. You can't see the pathway to God. You don't understand what God is all about. You don't see what Christ really came to do. He came to reconcile those who hated. Jesus didn't come to save you and I because we was good people. The Bible says he expressed his love when we were yet sinners. He came to teach us how to love somebody who may appear to be unlovable. And if we can learn to love, that's why Jesus said, you say you love, he said, shoot, the world love those in the world. He said, if you have my spirit in you, I'm trying to get you to grow in a love that will love those who don't love you. I need to teach you how to love somebody that don't even like you. Why? So they can see my truth. I need you, I'm going to give you three areas. I need you to teach, even especially when you're married, I need to teach you how to love somebody who won't do what you think they do, what you think they should do. Because a lot of divorces, man, she never did. I just wanted this one. I always tell me, I wanted this, I wanted that. Can you love somebody who won't do what you want them to do? That's number one. Number two, can you love somebody who won't walk in the position that you think they should walk in? Well, I think you need to, this is what I mean, or I think a woman. Well, Jesus loved you and you wasn't walking in no position that he thought you, he called you to walk as a son and daughter. You were walking as a heathen and a liar and a thief. But yet his love transcended you to walk out of, can you love them to that point? And last but not least, can you trust God with the ones you say you love? Trust God to bring them to that place. You're not God. Can you love them? What do I mean by that? Can you be patient until God give increase? Can you be long-suffering? Why is your first thought is to throw it away? Why is your first thought to trash it? Why is your first thought to quit? That's not what Jesus did. So how can you say you walk like Jesus and yet you don't love like Jesus? You say you walk like Jesus, but you don't love like Jesus? Yeah, I walk like Jesus. I prophesy. I walk like Jesus. I lay hands on the sick. You better go read Corinthians 13. Though you prophesy and get all kind of knowledge. If you have not love, because love was your truth. If that prophecy and love doesn't have, if you don't have the right heart, you still, he just said according to the word, if you don't love your brother, if you have the wrong heart, you are still in darkness. And your prophecy is probably swayed by your own desire and your false interpretation of Christ. What false interpretation? That all you needed God for was to please you. So when somebody don't please you, your interpretation of Christ says, dog them out. Disown them. A true interpretation of Christ is be long-suffering and patient, be forbearance. Some of us have a perverted interpretation of Christ. Your interpretation of Christ is based upon your own desires. And when somebody doesn't meet your desires, now the true you come out. You cursing them out. You angry, you bitter, you snap. Why? You have a false interpretation of Christ. Because guess what? You didn't do what Christ asked you to do the first time. In some areas, you ain't did it. Some of us, you ain't did it yet. And you and I, you and us in this nation, we better thank God that God who, the God that asks you, that the God that asks you to be long-suffering, you better embrace the fact that he is long-suffering. Can you trust God? Can you trust the word? He says, in whom I love in truth. The one he loved, can you trust? God love you. Trust him to get you in truth. And when he get him in truth, he'll sanctify him from sin. He'll remove him from that area. But you got to keep watering and planting. Well, I don't see no change. Well, trust the truth. Trust God's love for them, not yours. Because your love go in and out. He said, you remain in darkness if you do not love the brother. I've seen people, I'm going to tell you, I have seen people going around talking about they moving in power, talking about they prophesying, they preaching from pulpits. I have seen people, and in their heart, they hate people. According to truth, they remain in darkness. And you're like, that was a good word. I wish they would believe the word they're preaching, or yet they be a castaway. The evidence, see, the thing is, the fruit of the Spirit are from a tree of love. The evidence is not you speaking in tongues. That's, God can use a donkey to get somebody to see truth. That don't mean the donkey in good standing. Moses was not in good standing with God when the water came out the rock. So if you're using what, oh God using me, my, if you're using because you're speaking, if you're using because you learn, if that's your means of you, that's your means of saying, you know what, I'm good with God. You might want to go study the scripture, because John says that you know that you have come out of death into life in the way that you love the brethren. In your heart, if there is malice and envy and jealousy, if there is anger and bitterness against, you are to owe no man anything but to love him. If these things remain in your heart, you are still in darkness and you have not yet known Christ Jesus.
That's right.
You have a form and a fashion of godliness, denying the true power, what power? To change your heart and your heart toward others. It will never be okay with God for you to hate somebody. Backbiting, slandering, speaking ill. These things shall not be among the saints. These things are not to be among the saints. That's what the words say. That's the truth. Go ahead.
Verse 10. He who loves his brother abides in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him.
Oh, come on, can somebody scream? He who what?
Loves his brother.
Abides in the what?
The light.
See, he who abides in the light, there is no stumbling in him. He see where he going. He who loves his brother understands he can't be kissing on her. He who loves his brother, he who abides in the light, will not move in their flesh. There's no stumbling. We stumble because we cannot see. But the word should have caused you to see how valuable a soul is to God. Ooh, let me say that again. The word of God should have opened up your revelation to understand one thing, if you never got anything else, is that God loves, he would have died for one soul. He absolutely loves a soul. So how can you and I say we got the love of God in us and yet we hate souls? God has already told you and I to love even your enemy. How do you justify loving your, telling God, I love my enemy when you slander your brother? See, I'm going to tell you something. This must stop. See, Read the last part again.
Verse 10, he who loves his brother abides in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him.
See, I'm not going, when you're walking in the light of the word of God, remember I said, let's love someone to the protecting of their soul. When you're walking in the light, you're not going to sleep with that dude. You're not going to sleep with that female. Not because you're worried about going to hell, because you understand Christ and the love of God. You understand the price that it took for that soul. When somebody make a mistake, you're not going to condemn them and judge them, because you understand that there was a price paid if you walked with Christ. You're going to have hope even for those who are hopeless. Why? Because you understand when you walked in Christ what he did. Are we getting what God's saying, right? I'm telling y'all don't know. I'm telling you, it's a new movement. They talking about I know people talking about the supernatural, and yet in their heart, it is full of anger, bitterness. But they want to see God raise somebody from the dead. Raise you up first. Because for last time I checked, it is better to go into the kingdom main. It is better for you to go into the kingdom main. Meaning that if God don't raise you up and your heart is right, you see, you're going into the kingdom. Your physical condition, your body may have one leg or two legs. That's not determined if you go into the kingdom of God. You can be blind and go into the kingdom of God. God, don't get me wrong. God does the super, he does miracles, but they are to reveal the presence of God. And once God is present, you got to accept that gift that transforms the heart to the heart of God. Many of them saw many miracles and turned away from God. Some of them did miracles and told Jesus, I can't ride with you no more. You talking about drinking my blood, eating my flesh? I got to go. You're going a little too deep for me. I don't understand that. What did that mean? They didn't mind doing the miracles. You know why people don't, let me tell you why people don't mind doing miracles. Why people don't mind doing things like that. Because it makes them look good. It's true. Every time they did a miracle, the people would try to praise the apostles because it made the apostles look like they were supernatural. But the apostles were wise enough to give the glory to God. But watch this. When you do a miracle, it does make, if God used me right now and I lay hands on Paula and she began to see and she was blind, and everybody in this room knows she was blind, there's two things going to happen. She's going to see, everybody go, ooh, and then you're going to have people, they're going to run to the one who did the miracle. That's what they did with Jesus. They run to the one who, and they began to try to serve. And you got people who like being served. They like their name being called. They like this and this, and they like to say this and that. But when they did it, watch this, when they did it, they ripped their clothes and said, give a glory to God. We got a generation that says, we got a selfie generation. Give a glory to me. But then, right after they lay hands, if somebody pull in front of them, or the wife say, or their wife say something they don't like, or their husband say something they don't like, they will curse them out. They will go angry and bitter. Why? Because their heart is untransformed. And they will be the ones at the end, if they do not repent, they will say to the Lord, 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 we prophesied in your name. They will say to the Lord, watch the three things they say. They're going to say, Lord, we prophesied. Meaning we spoke in your behalf, God. Then they're going to say, Lord, we prophesied in your name, and we cast. Then they're going to say, they're going to have the audacity to tell God, and we cast out demons in your name. And then they're going to say, we did many wonders in your name. He didn't say, I knew you and you fell away. He said, you never knew Christ. You never knew what he came for. You never understood his heart. You worker of iniquity. What is iniquity? Lawlessness. In your heart. But God does not desire that for us. He does not desire that for you. That's why he said the day you hear the truth. He said when you hear the truth and you are pricked to your heart, do not be condemned. But let your heart be open and say, God, I hear what you are saying. A love that looks past my faults, and you know what I need. I need you. Because in my heart, I do have bitterness. In my heart, I have not forgiven my father. In my heart, I have bitterness when I was a child and I was molested. In my heart, God is still angry. And God, I know you, my Bible tells me that you are the mender of a broken heart. God, I am broken and I need you to heal my heart. I'm tired of going to church and trying to do this, trying to do that. I'm tired of doing all these things so people can see that I'm valuable. God, I need to know my value from you. Because if I never lay hands on the sick, if I never prophesy a word, but yet I accepted your gift, I'm accepted by the beloved. Read it and finish. Let's get ready to go. Was that it?
Verse 11. But he who hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he is going because the darkness has blinded his eyes.
He who does not love his brother, you walk in darkness. And the darkness has blinded you. You know what happens to blind people when they're not guided right? Boom. They get hurt. When you are in darkness, you get hurt. You get wounded. Because you can't see where you're going. Anybody been hurt? When was in the world? Wounded? Anybody been tormented? When we was in darkness, we couldn't see where we were going. We couldn't see what was inside the person's heart we were dealing with. We couldn't see. Because now when you can see, you know how to pray. Now when you can see, you got hope. Because you know what Christ is. You know what he has done. You look at your situation, you never feel hopeless. Why? Because you know your God is able. Why sing songs and you don't believe? The sons and daughters are not, they are not hopeless by what the things they see. Because they know the finished story. So I want to just say to today, I want to say right now, because I'm going to preach the second part of this evening. But I want to say, if you're sitting there and you're like, you know what, God, there's some issues in my heart. And you know what's funny with us? Some of us sitting here, and while you're sitting here, God has somebody flash before you. And this message today, God is saying, in whom I love in truth. What is God saying to, I love you in truth. So I have declared to you the truth today. So don't harden your heart when you hear this truth. Come to me and let me heal your heart. Come to me and let me deliver you from that. Let me take away the bitterness and the pain. Let me bring you to a place where love will just flow out of you. Let me give you great revelation of my son. Because the Bible says there's no greater love, no greater love than one who will lay down his life. People trying to be great by what they do for God, but they won't lay down their life for God. Or for nobody else. But y'all heard me say it before, and I'm going to say it again according to the word of God. You want to measure where you are? You want to really measure where you at? Look how you treat people. Satan can mimic anything. Satan can mimic a whole lot of stuff. When Moses threw down a rod, Satan threw down a rod to turn into a snake. Today, if you're talking about you raised somebody from the dead, guess what somebody in the hospital will tell you? Well, that doctor caused them. They were dead, and that doctor brought them back. I won't give no glory to God. That doctor raised somebody from the dead, too. But what they cannot copy, what Satan cannot copy, what he cannot reproduce, it's the love of God. He will not sacrifice. He will not sacrifice for another. He will not lay his life down. Why? Because he's selfish. Self-serving. Satan doesn't love his enemies. His desire is to kill, steal, and destroy them. Jesus came to give life to his enemies and life more abundantly. They are nothing alike. So we must choose to walk in truth. When you look at somebody, when you deal with somebody, say it, let that thing like sweetness come from your tongue like honey, and whom I love in truth. I don't love you in lust. I don't love you in money. I don't love you because you're body. I love you in truth. Why? Because truth sanctifies. Truth sets you apart. Puts you in a position of safety. Amen. If there's anybody under my voice that says, I need to get it right with God. God, I've seen these issues in my heart. I'll be popping off. I get angry so quick. When I get angry, I start cursing. I get mad. God ain't going to judge you. Just get it right with God. Some people are sitting here, some of